Good morning to you. It's 8 o'clock. Welcome back to CBS This Morning. U.S. officials dig for details of an al-Qaeda terror plot that may be underway. The State Department has closed embassies and consulates in the Middle East and Africa. Doctors say a two-year-old Pennsylvania boy, has only weeks to live, so his parents moved up their wedding and made him the best man. Plus, Oprah, as in Winfrey, is back in Studio 57. Woohoo! Yes, I'm excited about that. Her new movie, Lee Daniels, The Butler, is already getting Oscar talk. We'll see how Oprah's feeling about life as she approaches 60. I heard from reliable sources she's feeling pretty good. But first, here's a look at today's eye-opener at 8.
Sources tell us a major al-Qaeda plot is now in the final stages of planning.
American embassies and consulates in 19 Mideast and African nations remain closed this morning.
They're worried about all sorts of innovations coming from al-Asiri. He's not only a master bomb maker, but he's innovative.
The suspension is expected to last through the 2014 season, but A-Rod says he's going to play here in the Windy City tonight, no matter what.
Nathan Campbell fled the scene, but later turned himself into authorities. He's been charged with murder and is being held on $1 million bail.
An American military helicopter crashed this morning in Okinawa, Japan. Three of the four crew members on board ejected and survived. A fourth was injured and hospitalized.
Right now, their evacuation remains in place.
More than 100 families are out of their homes in central Louisiana after a train derailment. There are chemicals on board that could be deadly.
What will we not hear because he doesn't take the stand?
What we miss is learning about the true corruption of the government.
Johnny Manziel is accused of signing items in exchange for a fee.
And the preseason for Aggies football begins today, and officials for the team say Manziel will practice.
You guys film me from the time you get out of the car?
No, from the time you got out of bed.
Okay.
I'm Charlie Rose with Gail King and Nora O'Donnell. American officials say the newest terror threat from al-Qaeda appears to be the most detailed and serious one in years. United States embassies and consulates in 19 cities overseas will be closed all week.
A State Department spokeswoman says the closings were extended out of an abundance of a caution. Bob Orr is in Washington. Bob, good morning.
Good morning, Nora, Charlie, and Gail. Well, the intercepted communications of al-Qaeda leaders suggest now that a major plot is underway and that terror operatives have likely already been dispatched with orders. Intelligence analysts now are scrambling to fill in all the information gaps. They're hoping to get enough specifics to ultimately disrupt the plot. While a number of U.S. embassies, as we've noted, have been closed, we're not exactly sure what targets al-Qaeda is seeking to hit or when. Transportation systems, private facilities of U.S. and Western nations also could be at risk. Now, this threat traces back to al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, and that is one of the reasons for concern here. AQAP in Yemen is the most aggressive and capable of all the al-Qaeda franchises and is specifically tasked now by al-Qaeda headquarters to lead any attacks on America. Charlie, Nora?
Bob, is there some concern that this latest chatter may in some way be a distraction for an attack that may take place somewhere else?
Well, Charlie, there's a lot we don't know, but intelligence officials say that they believe the communications are genuine and it's not some attempted misdirection. They know al-Qaeda is planning some kind of attack, but they admit they don't know where. Now, Yemen is very high on the target list because the terrorists, of course, are already there. But it's worth noting that al-Qaeda has hit Europe in the past and the U.S. in the past, and officials say they'd do that again if they could. And one more thing, embassies are prime targets because they, of course, are symbols of the West, but so too, I'm afraid, is aviation. And as we know, al-Qaeda has shown a continuing interest in attacking U.S.-bound airplanes.
Thanks, Bob.
Bob Orr, we thank you. Yankee slugger Alex Rodriguez is about to take a big hit. CBSSports.com says he will be suspended through next season for using performance-enhancing drugs. That is the heaviest punishment by far as baseball officials plan to sideline up to a dozen players. Rodriguez is going to appeal, and he expects to play for the Yankees tonight in Chicago.
Missy Franklin became a swimming star last year, winning 4 gold medals at the London Olympics. The 18-year-old from Colorado did even better this past week in Barcelona, Spain. Franklin became the first woman to win 6 events at the World Swimming Championships. One competitor calls her Wonder Woman with a cape. Franklin says, "I have a lot of room to improve."
Impressive. Go Missy.
Go Missy is right. New dad Prince William is back on the polo field after Saturday's match with Prince Harry. William said, like all new fathers, it was good to get out of the house. He also said, I was in baby mode out there thinking about diapers. I wasn't really in the zone. Also like new fathers. It's the first time we've heard from him since his wife Kate took Prince George home from the hospital.
You know how that is after you have a baby. You're like, let me just get out of the house for a little bit.
And then you want to go back home.
You do.
You want to go back home.
That's right. And a happy bride and groom got married this weekend in Gannett, Pennsylvania, just outside of Pittsburgh. But their best man got most of the attention. He is the couple's two-year-old son, and he is terminally ill. As Jeff Pegues reports, the ceremony marked a celebration of love and life.
For Christine Swiderski and Sean Stevenson, the words in sickness and in health mean so much more.
We're married! Yay!
On Saturday, the two were married in front of more than 100 friends and family, but the most cherished of them was their two-year-old son, Logan.
This is the little guy that we did this for today.
Logan was born with Fanconi anemia, a rare genetic disorder. He has also undergone rounds of chemotherapy and surgery to fight off leukemia and cancer. But last month, doctors said Logan had only weeks to live. Faced with the devastating news, his parents moved up their wedding day by a whole year, determined to have Logan share in one of the happiest days of their lives.
We just decided to go ahead and do it while he was still with us. And we did it everything as soon as we could.
The decorations, the canopy, even the bride's dress were borrowed from other weddings. Donations poured in from total strangers. The backyard ceremony came together within a week.
Family and friends came and took care of it while me and Sean sat in the house and we were just with our children, spending time with them, which made it nice. Didn't have to worry for once.
And all the people that had donated stuff, it's just been wonderful, the community, the Pittsburgh area. I mean, everybody, I just can't thank you enough.
No one was upset when the best man fell asleep in his grandmother's arms. And after Christine and Sean pledged their lives to each other, they vowed to continue fighting for Logan's.
This is our dream come true, all our family together, and we're all together celebrating the celebration of my son's life and the celebration of our marriage.
For CBS This Morning, Jeff Pegues, Washington.
Nothing sadder than somebody dying before their time, is it? Especially if they're that young.
And what do you see out of that? It shows how people come together, though, in times like that.
Yes, and very nice, and that he got to be the best man and celebrate there with his two parents, and he's fighting a very tough fight against leukemia and cancer.
It is now 8:07. Time now to check your local weather. Oprah is about to join us at the table. We sure have a lot to discuss today, including...
I'm ready.
Her new movie. We are ready.
We are ready
for you. Her new movie.
Bring her on.
Lee Daniels of Butler. It's already getting a lot of Oscar talk, Oprah. Yay. Oprah's coming up next on CBS This Morning. Oprah Winfrey returns to the big screen this month for her first major film role in 15 years. She co-stars in Lee Daniels' The Butler. It's based on the true story of a man who worked in the White House under 8 presidents. In some of the most tumultuous years of the 20th century, here's a clip.
Sidney Poitier is nothing but a rich Uncle Tom. Look at you. All puffed up. Put your hat on your head. Coming in here, saying whatever you want. You need to go.
What?
Get the hell out of my house!
What are you doing?
No, no, get on out!
Now everybody just sit
down. I'm sorry, Mr. Butler. I didn't mean to make fun of your hero.
Everything you are and everything you have is because of that butler.
Woo, Oh, we've seen. Wow. I know, big sigh when you look at it, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
welcome to you, Oprah Winfrey.
Well, thank you.
It feels weird to call you Oprah Winfrey. I'm just going to call you Oprah.
Okay.
So 15 years it took you to come back to the big screen, and I know you had some trepidation. Was it the smoking? Was it the love scene? Was it that it's been 15 years?
Well, it was because I was in the middle of building a network, and I said, you could not have called me at a worse time. But it's also because it's like an instrument, you know, the acting tool. And it's like laying down an instrument. If you played piano, you hadn't picked up a piano, you hadn't picked up a, you know, trombone in 15 years, you put it in the corner. I'd given up the idea of acting because I just felt the day job and the complications of trying to figure out somebody who could do a movie at the same time I was also working. I just sort of let that go.
But you said Lee was persistent. You just didn't want to be embarrassed. And I thought, how could you
but
be
But Lee was persistent. Lee was like, listen, I wrote this for you, and Danny Strong and I wrote this for you, and you have to say yes. So I ended up saying yes because of the story. Yeah. I felt that.
And it ought to be said, acting is tough, and you've got some tough things to deliver here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a little, and I was really nervous about it. So I actually called in an acting coach. And
for
the first time. And Susan Batson said to me, I think you have the ability to access it because you still are far more vulnerable. Mm. Because I called her in because I have trouble crying. Can you believe that?
No.
I have trouble crying if you ask me to do it on cue.
Yeah.
And after 20 minutes of, you know, bawling on the sofa after she'd been with me for 20 minutes, she said, you still have the vulnerable spaces, so you'll be able to go in and access that.
Yeah.
I had no trouble crying during this movie because it is so emotionally riveting. Obviously, there's great acting, but the story.
Oh, thank you so much,
Nora. The story. And I think it's let's talk about the story because it is about the butler. It's a real life story of Eugene Allen.
Yes.
Who served 8 presidents. You, in the movie, he's called Cecil Gaines, and you play the wife, yeah. Gloria Gaines. Why was this story so important to tell?
Because I think the women of the civil rights movement, the women who stood by their men, the women who had to repress their own heart's desires, their own ambitions, because the world saw you in this box, I think that they played a vital and essential role to the movement, but nobody ever talks about them. Mm-hmm. And I think that entire era of women deserves, you know, not just applause, but deserves to be celebrated and honored. And also at the time, before I started working with Susan, I thought, well, it's just the wife and it won't take that long. And and then I realized every line, to do 3 lines is essential. So it took a lot more work than I thought at the time. But the ability to tell that story so that the generation, our generation, it affirms what we already know about history, but there's a whole generation that will now have an opportunity to be exposed to it. It's so amazing.
It's going an
to
education for a lot of people.
Yeah,
it's
because,
a forward,
you know,
suite through history and you get all the connections.
Yes, and it's a drama, it's a history lesson, and it's a love story. But the thing is, you know, I speak at a lot of schools, used to speak at a lot of schools when I had the time, and I came to see that Martin Luther King was just a speech for kids. It was just an I have a dream, and then some kids get up and recite it, but they had no sense of what that meant, the context of what that meant. So this offers I think a great opportunity for kids.
I'm not saying that you are hard to direct, but Lee Daniels did say you asked a whole lot of questions during the set.
Yeah. First of all,
you want to know like details.
Well, I wanted to know. He's speaking specifically about during the love scene when Forrest and I are in bed together. I want to know what time of day is it? Because is it morning
sex? Why does that matter?
Because is it morning sex or is it evening sex? Is it afternoon? Did we just come home in the afternoon?
And they're all different, aren't they?
They're all different, Charlie.
Okay. Wait, how long? This interview has been going on, Oprah. This interview's been going on 2 minutes, and now you've gotten to our favorite subject on this show, which we touch on it every single day.
No, in some way.
The opening presents itself, we grab it.
Yes, grab it, yes. Yeah, you do. If you're in bed, don't you want to know what time it is? Because what's going on depends on, you know, do I have to get up?
Not normally what I'm thinking, but okay.
And on that point, this is not just about the butler, and of course, and the backdrop is the civil rights movement. Yeah. It's about a love story.
Oh, my God. Yes. Can we talk about Forrest Whitaker?
Yes.
Oh.
As I said, through the roof, but even bigger.
Through the roof, but even bigger. Yes. Because, you know, when I first saw the film, Roger Ebert told me years ago that when I did The Color Purple, he goes, don't look at it for 5 years because you can't really see yourself, which is true. Huh. So you can't see yourself. But when I finished the film for the first time, what I saw and felt was that Forrest was able to evoke the soul of not just Eugene Allen, but every man in that era. You know, you feel that, and through that, you feel the spirit of the nation through that performance.
And everybody cries at this movie at different points and for different reasons. There was something released about Barbara Bush. Lee was saying that Barbara Bush had seen it and she cried, but people cry at different times, and it's quite often Forrest.
Forrest got two things for me. One was dignity. He
yes.
got the dignity of the man.
What about that scene when he goes in and he asks the administrator?
It goes in. We both love that as our favorite yeah. scene. He yeah. goes in and he knows the guy's going to say, if it's a choice between doing what you asked me to do and not, you can leave.
Yes.
And he reminds him, I've already told the president this is what you might say.
Yes.
And the president said he'd like to talk to you.
Oh, personally. My goodness.
This is the context of asking for that the butlers in the White House,
right.
the black butlers, were paid less than white staff
yes.
in the White House.
So he goes in. You know what? So remarkable about this film, it is, I think, indicates that there are two different ways or multiple ways to protest.
Right.
For the father of that generation and that period, that was major for him. Think about how long it would take him to go in and ask for more money and the risk that he would take. He could have been fired. That was his way of being a warrior.
And the son had another way.
And for his son, that was another way. And the truth is, both ways were right.
We're right.
Both
that time.
That's what this movie is about.
We're up against a hard wall. The good news for us is you've agreed to stick around. We like that. Lee Daniels, the butler, opens
the
theaters on
August. Why not?
How could you say no to us, Oprah? On August 16th. We'll get her thoughts on her life as she approaches her 60th birthday and look at the success of OWN. Lots to talk to you about. That's ahead on CBS.
This portion of CBS This Morning sponsored by Kleenex brand tissues. Now they're thicker and more absorbent.
Welcome back to CBS This Morning. Oprah Winfrey still at the table. We will continue our conversation with her in just a sec. But also coming up in this half hour, it took Jackie Robinson to bring down baseball's color barrier. Until then, black players turned to the Negro Leagues. Today, nearly 100 years later, you'll meet some of the athletes who are about to shake hands with President Barack Obama.
Plus, we return to sex. Are we born monogamous? Two new studies look at our ability to be loyal. Oprah shaking her head. And the sex therapist tells us what leads some people to stray. That story's ahead.
Right now it's time to share some of this morning's headlines. The Boston Globe looks at its own sale. The buyer, John Henry, also owns the Red Sox. Henry paid $70 million for the 141-year-old newspaper. It was not the highest bid, but it was all cash. That and his local roots were enough to convince the current owner, the New York Times, to sell.
USA Today looks at a slow exit for compact disc players in cars. Few automakers have eliminated CD units altogether, even with digital music taking over. But in some new models, the players are hidden away. That's because most people still own stacks of CDs.
The News Times in Danbury, Connecticut says the game show Jeopardy is under fire for a very controversial decision. It seems a middle school student from Newtown was a contestant on Kids Week. 12-year-old Thomas Hurley got the final Jeopardy answer correct, but he misspelled it, so the judges ruled against him. No fair. Outraged viewers bombarded Jeopardy's Facebook page. Thomas says he's proud to have been selected as a contestant for the show, but he's no longer a fan.
And the Des Moines Register says the Powerball lottery jackpot has grown to $400 million. There was no grand prize winner after Saturday's drawing. It's the third largest Powerball jackpot ever. The odds of winning, 1 in 175.2 million. The next drawing is Wednesday.
So how many tickets will you be buying? Because if you win, people will be so happy for you.
Yeah, I know. When I saw that, I was thinking, how many tickets have you bought?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know I've bought a couple.
I know. And have you bought it for all the crew, too?
As a matter of fact, I did.
Yeah, I know. That's
that was
said.
A surprise at the end of the show. But yes, I did. Yes, I did.
You read that well, my dear.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Yeah.
Oprah's new movie, Lee Daniels, The Butler, opens in theaters on August 16th. And even while filming her role, Oprah kept busy running OWN and conducting some of the biggest interviews of the year, including Lindsay Lohan.
Oh.
Oh.
I just did that yesterday or a day before. Yeah.
As they say, OWN is rocketing forward, isn't it?
Well, yes. What a different story than what?
When you were here.
When I was here. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Last year.
Right.
What a difference a year
What
makes.
Did you do?
What I did, it's not what I did. It's, well, it is what I did and the team did.
Yeah.
So I, you know, when you are in a foxhole, you have to surround yourself with people who can help lift you out. Right. We did. I said it was a huge climb, and now we are having fun.
Yep.
We're making money. We are really in the business and doing very well. So I'm very happy about that.
Could we
thanks
go back
to my team.
And it is a team. It really is. It's a team. It takes a village. But can I go back to Lindsay Lohan just for a second? Because a lot of people had their lips curled up about that. I would say
you would be one of them.
Yes, I might even have had my
nothing like booking a Lindsay Lohan and Gail calling up saying, "What do you do that for?"
No, I had some concerns, but I was not the only one, though, Oprah. I was not the only one because they're thinking, "Why is Oprah?"
Yes, you brought a list of everyone else who also had their lips curled up. Thank you so much.
Yes, you're welcome. Uh-huh. And to the doubters, you say,
but I don't understand why people are doubting, because this is what I know. We're all on the same journey. People are taking different paths to get there. Mm-hmm. And I think no matter how many times you fail, you fall down in your life, I mean, you certainly have the opportunity until you take your last breath to be redeemed. So, you know, I'm in the business of interviewing people about their lives. Mm-hmm. And so to sit and to talk to her about where she is in her life, and I did the other day, and I felt that she was honest, that she was authentic, and that she is ready. And I asked her, what's the difference between now and all the other five times mm-hmm. that you've been through rehab. Yeah. And part of the issue was those were all forced by the court, you know, mm-hmm. in order to stay out of jail.
Did you believe her this time? And how was she?
I believed her, and she looked good. She looked strong. She looked healthy. And
was she on time?
Not only was she on time, she was earlier than I was. She was 20 minutes early.
Okay.
And then we had another meeting with her yesterday where she was 20 minutes early. So I think that she is, you know, on the way to...
Listen, she's very talented.
Yes.
I'm pulling for her, Oprah.
Yes. And I said to her, I want you to win. Yeah.
This is part of a docu-series that you're doing with her, part of some programming changes that you're making,
well,
right?
Well, I'm doing an interview with her for Next Chapter, which will air next week, but I'm also doing, we're also at OWN doing an 8-part docu-series of her life, so looking at the process of what it is like to come out of rehab and try to put your life back together when you have lived your life in the fishbowl. I will say this. I felt this when I interviewed Justin Bieber. And I felt it all the years of, you know, being in the public eye. You would understand this, too, you all, in the public eye. I don't know how you do this when you are a child mm-hmm. with no... I asked her a question of, you know, she was making $7 million when she was 18 years old. Who
was guiding her?
No one. Yeah, so you're 17 years old, 18 years old, with $7 million. That's an out of control waiting to happen.
So in addition to OWN, in addition to a movie, you also have a magazine. And I really, with my magazine hat, want to unveil the September cover, which...
Listen, you've been a cover girl for a very long time.
Yeah, go ahead.
Do you think I could do the hairdo?
Yes.
I would.
No, I don't.
I wouldn't pay Powerball money to see it, but I would love to see it.
No, and people always say to me, God, Oprah's always on the cover.
I'm trying to get off of that cover.
I said, she's been asking for 5 years. Take me off the cover.
Okay. I've been asking since, I think, the 5th anniversary to come off the cover.
Yeah. So here we are. OWN is back. OWN is where you wanted to be.
You've got this. Where I wanted to be, but we're growing.
It's heading in the right direction.
Headed in the right direction.
What is it, 160 covers?
But look, there's a premiere issue there. Yeah. I look at that and crack up.
Yeah.
So you got the magazine.
Yes.
You got this great movie.
Yeah.
Everything seems to be going the right direction, and you're approaching 60.
Whoa. Can you believe that? The 60 number, I've always said to people to own it. But I'm telling you, Gail, who reminded me, you're going to be 60 this year. thank you, Gail.
That's a friend you need. Choose that.
No,
you know, you're going to be 60.
And she looks so great. That's the thing. Remember,
you're
going to be 60.
Used to be old. Yeah, but I mean, who've said to women all these years, own it, took a pause for that, took a beat for that. But you know what?
Why?
Just a pause, like, whoa, 60, because you think of what you thought 60 was or what you imagined 60 to be. But this is how I live my life. I think about all the people that didn't make it. Yeah. And every time I come to New York, and many times just getting dressed in the morning, I often think about 9/11. I think about all of those people who were getting dressed that morning and didn't make it. And so I think to be able to claim that number, to own it,
exactly.
Bring it on, 60! Yeah. Then when I hear women are going to turn 40 and they're like, I can't believe I'm going to turn 40, it's so irritating.
You'll find it gets better and better and better.
It does?
It really does.
That's what Maya Angelou says. It gets better and better and better. Yeah.
So I'm no AARP card for you.
Well, I think I qualified at 50.
I know. We did qualify at 50, Oprah, and I called them and said, take me off the list. Yeah. I said, the interview you just did, though, with Hugh Jackman, where you said he was asking you something about your life, and you said, with each chapter of my life, though, Hugh, I never planned it out.
Yeah.
I never planned it out. It all just sort of organically happened for me. Do you still feel
because
that?
I try to live in the flow. That's what I teach my girls. You know, I have now 16 girls in the United States, all starting college, and we're all, you know, dividing.
Graduates of South Africa.
South Africa. Yeah. And we're going to be putting them all, another group coming in September going to college. And what I try to teach them is the way I live myself, live in the flow. And sometimes it's so funny, they'll call me and go, Mama, I'm out of flow. Get yourself back in flow. Once you get yourself back in flow.
But is there something, people do use birthdays as milestones, you know what I mean? 40th, 50th, 60th birthdays. Is there something in your 60th birthday that you plan to do, want to do?
I'm going to have the biggest blowout party I can dream of. That's what I'm going to do. I think I'm going to do that. You know, all these years I've had parties for other people, celebrating legends, celebrating other people. I think I'm going to do one for myself.
So is anything missing?
No, I don't find that anything is missing. I feel that I'm on the path to, you know, continuing to do exactly what I was meant to do here on planet Earth. And
there was a story in the news last week about women who made the decision not to have children. And that was a decision you made at a very early age.
I know,
age
and
too.
You wanted me to have children.
I know,
for
I did.
So that your children and my children could grow up together.
No, but Oprah, remember I called you once. I said, look, I just met somebody. They're 51. They've never been married. They never have children. There's dead silence on the phone. She goes, and?
I really have no regrets about that. But I've been on the road for a while, and I'm missing my dogs, okay? Yeah. I am missing that, but I have no regrets. And, you know, I think what we're doing with OWN, what we're doing with Life Class, T.D. Jakes and I are going to be doing a big Life Class down in Dallas soon. I think this morning I did the Deepak Chopra meditation. I think being able to offer the energy of service and helping people to find the best of themselves in life, that is exactly the path that I want to be on.
And that is, in the end, the kind of legacy you most want?
Yes, I think the legacy is, for me, for you, for all of us, is every life that was touched by you. Everybody who encountered you, what was that experience for them? That's your legacy. I think that's the oh wow moment that Steve Jobs had when he took his last breath. Oh wow. Everything mattered.
It's a great story.
You did such a good job. Isn't she good? Isn't it Nora, first time meeting her?
I know.
She never disappoints.
I'm going to live in my flow. I am living in my
flow. Find your flow.
Find
your flow. When things aren't going well, that's because you're out of flow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much. The movie is sensational.
Thank you.
And so are you, and so is Forrest.
Thank you.
Everybody.
No, Forrest is it's Forrest's movie.
You don't like to hear Oscar. She hates it when you say Oscar.
I don't say any Oscar talk.
No, but I'm saying that I've said it, and she shuts the conversation.
But
it
is, in the end, it is Forrest's movie. This is a guy who really, you see him age and you see all the human qualities.
Yeah. You feel the spirit of the nation because he lets us see this butler's soul.
You see history and you see his soul.
Yeah. Thank you.
Some of the men and women who played in baseball's Negro Leagues are being honored in Washington. Their history dates back to the 1920s when the game was segregated. Elaine Keanu is at the White House. Elaine, good morning.
Good morning to you, Charlie, Nora, and Gail. Well, President Obama is going to be meeting with a small group of former players here at the White House this evening. The oldest is 97, the youngest 74. Now, as age catches up with these men and women, there is a push to recognize their place in history.
When baseball was divided by color, African Americans found a home in the Negro Leagues.
This was the last glove I had.
As a young boy, Jim Robinson, now 83 years old, attended games with his father at Yankee Stadium.
What do you remember about those?
The Negro League games used to have far more people than the New York Giants. There used to be 40, 45,000 people there.
By 1950, Robinson made the leap from fan to player.
My first game in the Negro Leagues was in Yankee Stadium, so I thought that was a big deal.
The Negro League started in 1920. It's where Jackie Robinson got his start before integrating the major leagues in 1947. That was the beginning of the end for the Negro teams. Nearly 10 years later, they folded. More than 2,000 men played, and a few women.
One day out of the clear blue, he asked me if I wanted to play professional baseball. I said, hell yeah. When do I go? When do I leave?
In 1953, Mamie Johnson was recruited on this field in Washington, D.C. The 77-year-old was the first woman pitcher in the Negro Leagues.
And I was so pleased, you know, striking out the fellas and laughing.
Their love for the game helped them overcome the challenges of racism and Jim Crow America.
To me, it is the really beginning of the civil rights movement, because here's a bunch of guys that wanted to play baseball and they weren't allowed to play in the major leagues, but they said, okay, we'll have a league of our own.
And now, more than half a century later, these men and women who experienced the sting of segregation are being recognized by the nation's first African-American president for playing the American pastime they love.
I'm hoping I can get close, you know. I'm hoping I can say, hi, you know. I'm Jim, you know. I know who you are.
I'm gonna tell Mrs. Obama, I hope you don't get mad, but I just gotta hug him.
Now, Jim Robinson told me that he has been to Washington, D.C. many times, and he actually played baseball here as a young man, but he has never before been inside the White House. Now, the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum estimates there are only about 150 of these former players still alive today. Charlie, Gail, Nora.
Great story. Elaine Cajano, thank you. And is monogamy natural? Two new studies are reigniting the debate. We're going to talk with a leading sex therapist. That's next. Listen to this music. But first, a check of your local weather. Oh my gosh.
I'm here with Oprah.
She wanted to stay because it's such an interesting story.
Yes, I wanted to see what the results say.
Yes, scientists have long wondered why some mammals, including humans, are monogamous. Now, two new studies offer different answers, neither of which are based on romance. One says fathers stick around to protect their young from being killed. The other concludes animals paired off so males could guard their mates and claim their breeding rights. Dr. Steven Snyder is an associate clinical professor of psychiatry at the Mount Sinai Medical Center and a sex therapist. How are you? Good morning.
Very good. Thanks for having me.
Okay, two different sex studies.
Dr.
What do they
Snyder,
show?
Oprah. Hi. Oprah, Dr.
How do you
Snyder.
Do?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what do we know now?
Well, we know that human monogamy is a drama that's been going on for a long, long time. Our predecessors, we're apes, and we're from the promiscuous part of the ape family, along with the chimpanzees and the bonobos. There's no doubt about that, right?
No question.
You look on the news every day.
Yeah.
Lots of sleeping around in our part of the ape family. But about 4 million years ago, something happened, probably because of the threat of infanticide. Fathers wanted to hang around and protect their children from rival males.
Okay, here's my problem with these studies,
is
that they're based on animals, not based on humans. That we're attributing what is animal behavior about monogamy to human beings.
Ah, that's the start of monogamy. We think the start of monogamy was 4 million years ago, not human beings yet. These are the relatives of chimps and bonobos that are going to eventually become human beings.
But can you just get to this question?
Yeah.
Are we as human beings, are we naturally monogamous? Or is Oprah's shaking her head no.
Or is promiscuity
in the DNA? Because I would like to think that...
I can answer that really quickly.
Okay.
We are not naturally monogamous. Okay?
You couldn't be.
That's
right.
What Oprah
right.
said
so let me tell
for,
more.
Yeah, for years.
Our foundation.
I don't want it to be so.
Well, we'll get there, okay? Our foundation...
Well, you can be.
Okay. Yes, I am.
Yes, yes and I expect my husband
yeah,
to be.
And I am too, but I'm just saying, for the species, it's not.
And I'm going to try and get you all there. I'm just going to show you how it happens, okay?
Okay.
We're not naturally monogamous. Our foundations are promiscuous, because we're from the promiscuous part of the ape family with the bonobos and the chimpanzees. 4 million years ago, probably... I believe one of these studies about primates, it was probably to prevent infanticide, the fathers started to hang around. And there began to develop the beginnings of emotions that most of us rely on to keep families together. Possessiveness,
right.
Jealousy,
mm-hmm.
and once in a while, romantic love. Okay?
Charlie, you have an opinion on this?
I agree with Oprah on this. I mean, I think it's a natural instinct, and I think the thing that keeps you, those that don't, has to do with values and love and for the people.
What we want and what is the natural instinct, they have to exert discipline
because you obviously attracted to more than one person.
What did you say, what we want?
What we want,
yes.
And what is the natural order of things
exactly.
is very different.
Exactly.
All right, Dr. Steven Snyder, I have to wrap. Yeah. Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, great to have
you.
Okay. That's what I was going to tell you, Dr. Snyder. This is TV.
Hello.
And it's live. Yes.
Oprah, thank you.
And it's live.
I didn't get to tell you.
That's it for us. You're watching CBS This Morning. We'll be right back. Okay, you want to make one last point about monogamy?
Yeah, that the doctor said that we get there, but it's worth it. That's the one point he wanted to leave on that note, Charlie. And I believe that.
I'm with you.
The movie's called Lee Daniels Butler, and I'm with thrill to have.
August 16th. Thank you. This has been great spending the morning with you.
Thank you for staying for the whole time.
Yes,
that does it for us. Up next to local news. We'll see you tomorrow on CBS This Morning.
Great being with you guys.
Hey,
thank you, Larry.
Closed captioning is proudly sponsored by Citracal.